Good morning, everyone. My name is Lisa Artiga, and I'm a New Knowledge Adventures volunteer. New Knowledge Adventures is also known as NKA. It is a completely volunteer-driven program that has been in the Treasure Valley since 2015. It is modeled after a very successful program from Pocatello. We are very grateful for our volunteer instructors, presenters, and all of the committee members that serve on various committees who are all volunteer, and they are people who share with us our love for lifelong learning. And I know that many of you have probably heard that before because you are veteran attendees of New Knowledge Adventures. So thank you for being here today. It's my pleasure to introduce our presenter, Alexander Sapiens. He's a professor emeritus from San Jose State University in California. Don't hold that against him, please. When Alexander retired in 2009, he decided that bird watching, or birding as it's commonly known, would be a great hobby. And to that end, a great hobby for keeping his mind active and his learning challenged. To that end, he has traveled the world and visited Asia, Europe, Central America, South America, and has birded in many states throughout the United States and Canada and New Zealand. He served for 6 years on the board of the Golden Eagle Audubon Society and is a member of the Southwest Idaho Birders Association. Alexander enjoys sharing his knowledge with others, and he has done frequent presentations on the birds of the various countries that he's visited. And one of his favorite places to bird is here in the Treasure Valley. So without further ado, I am going to turn this over to Alexander, who will begin his presentation.
Good morning. This is a new topic for me. I usually do birding presentations in different regions, but this time we're doing bird trivia. Let's share the screen. And so we're gonna share the screen here and get this thing on the road. Okay, so here we go. We're actually gonna cover 11 different topics. And what I'm going to do is at the end of each topic, except for the first one, which is very short, is pause and see if there are any questions that we need to respond to. So if you have questions, put them in the chat box, and then at the end of each section, with the exception of origin, we will respond to questions. So the origin of birds is that they are descendants of dinosaurs. And the first feathered dinosaur is from the late Jurassic era, which is Archaeopteryx. And so that's the most famous one, but there are actually a lot of new feathered dinosaurs that are coming out of China. And so in the last 10 years, there are a lot of feathered dinosaurs that have been discovered. And so if you want to read a very interesting book on the origin of birds, I would suggest Flying Dinosaurs by John Pickett. Okay, how am I moving? Okay, so we're now going to go to diversity. And there are about 10,000 species of birds. Now, most bird species are actually found in South America, which is about 3,200. But if you wanted to go to one country that has almost 3,000 species, I would suggest Colombia. Now, about 10 years ago, I did go to Colombia on a birding trip. And I actually got close to 500 new species in that 10-day tour. So I was totally blown away. Okay, this is not moving for me. How are you advancing?
I'm just clicking on the screen.
Okay, so we're going to look at the smallest bird first. And the smallest bird is actually the bee hummingbird, which is found in Cuba. And it's only about 2 inches long and weighs 0.06 of an ounce, or 1.7 grams. And the smallest hummingbird in the United States is one that we have here in Idaho, and that's the calliope hummingbird. Now that the calliope is 3 inches long and weighs about 1/10 of an ounce, or 2.8 grams. And so, here are two pictures of the bee hummingbird and the calliope hummingbird. And then that's a male calliope, by the way.
We're going to watch this.
I will. Yeah, I want to go listen to that.
Can I sit by you? We're going to watch it right here.
Yeah.
Okay. Can the other people mute?
Can I sit by you?
Yes.
Can I sit by you?
Yes.
Okay.
Can
you
sit up?
That would be good.
Okay. Can the other people watching please mute their computers? The largest bird in the world is actually the ostrich. And a male ostrich can be as tall as 9 feet.
What's he talking about?
Okay, somebody's talking in the background. They need to mute. So please go and mute your
computer.
Okay, so a male ostrich can weigh up to 330 pounds. I've actually seen pictures of people riding ostriches. The female is somewhat smaller, and ostriches are native to Africa. So here's a picture of a male ostrich on the right and two female ostriches.
The male is on the left.
I mean, take that back. The male is on the left. Sometimes I can't tell my right from my left. Okay, now, for longest living birds, the parrots have been known to live as long as 100 years. And that's a blue macaw that's shown. And there are 398 species of psittaciforms, or parrots. And the order is subdivided into three superfamilies: the true parrots, the cockatoos, and then the New Zealand parrots. And fortunately, I've been able to see all three in the wild. Now we're going to go to a unique bird, and it's a songbird that eats songbirds. And it is the loggerhead shrike. And you can notice it has a little hook bill. And it's been known as the butcher bird because it will take smaller songbirds and kill them with its hooked beak. And then it will take the uneaten prey and hook it on a thorn or barbed wire. Now, I've seen them on barbed wire fences. And so we do have the loggerhead shrike here in southern Idaho. Now we're going to move to eggs. Oh, by the way, we just switched gears or topics. So were there any questions?
I did not see any questions, but I do want to let everybody know, if you're going to put a question out in the chat, make sure you put it out to everybody, not just to one individual, so everybody can see your questions. But I don't have any for this topic so far.
Good. So now we're moving to eggs. So we're going to do hummingbird eggs, killdeer eggs, ostrich eggs, and kiwi eggs. So here's a comparison of the eggs. So you can see that the hummingbird egg is actually the smallest in actual size. And they're about the size of a jelly bean. Now, here's a picture with a hummingbird nest. They usually have two eggs, and there's a dime to show you. They're quite small. They're just a bit larger than a walnut. And they only lay two eggs at a time. And the next one are killdeer. Killdeer actually don't make nests. They lay their eggs on the ground, but they tend to be camouflaged. So unless you're really looking closely, you will not see them. And the chicks are precocial, meaning that they walk immediately after they hatch. And they look like little walking ping pong balls, but colorful. Now the ostrich egg. The ostrich egg can weigh up to 3 pounds. It's the largest egg, and they're about 6 inches in diameter. The eggs are laid in a communal nest of up to 60 eggs, and both males and females actually lay on the eggs. And both will raise their young. But in terms of percentage of body weight, the ostrich egg is actually smaller than the hummingbird egg. And then the egg that probably surprises everyone is the kiwi egg. Kiwis weigh about 2,500 grams, and the average egg weighs 371 grams. That's 15% of its body weight. And their eggs are the largest relative to body weight of any existing bird. And of course, if you see the egg beside the kiwi, you can understand why they only lay one egg a year. That egg is 6 inches long and 5 inches wide. It's amazing they could hatch something that big. So, any questions? Don't see any questions. Moving along. Now we're going to move to nests. The hummingbird.
Alexander, yeah. There was one question. How big was the ostrich? Ostrich.
The bird itself?
Yes.
Well, they can grow as tall as 9 feet and weigh up to 330 pounds. So they're taller than people and they weigh more. Okay?
That's it.
Yeah. So now we're gonna look at hummingbird nests, eagles, owls, belted kingfisher, which occur here, killdeer, and then we're going to look at the cowbird. So the first one is a hummingbird nest. And I said they're tiny. And because of their size, the nests usually only hold 2 eggs. And the thing that's really unique about hummingbird nests is they use a lot of spider silk or spider webs to bind their nests together. They're really tiny.
And that's a hunting what?
Hummingbird.
That's a hummingbird. So now we're going to the largest nest, from smallest to largest. And the bald eagles make the largest nest of all birds because they use their nests for many years and they keep adding to the nests. And so there was an eagle nest in Florida that was 9 feet wide, 20 feet deep, and weighed 3 tons. Okay, and so when you see these old nests, the width stays about the same, but they get taller and taller because they keep piling on new sticks. Okay, now we're going to the owls. And on the left is a screech owl. And so it nests in a tree. And the other one would be the burrowing owl. And they're both what are called cavity nesters. And so the burrowing owl doesn't actually build its own nest, but will take holes that are made by other animals and take them over. And I've actually helped build burrowing owl nests. And they usually use a 4 to 6 inch tube, which will extend maybe 10 feet. And at the end of the tube, we bury a 5 gallon can, a plastic can. And then that's how most of their cavities exist. Now, this particular burrowing owl, I was watching on Cole Road and I saw a weasel approach it. And the thing that amazed me about the burrowing owl is it didn't attack the weasel, but it made a sound that sounded exactly like a rattlesnake. And the weasel kind of perked up, couldn't tell where the sound was coming from, and scooted away. So that was kind of surprising how they use sound as a defense mechanism and not just camouflage. And then on the Boise River, this spring we saw a belted kingfisher go to its nest. Now they dig a long, narrow nest, tunnel into a riverbank. And at the end of the tunnel is a nesting chamber. And those tunnels can be 3 to 5 feet long. And I guess the longest one that's ever been found was 10 feet long. And the belted kingfisher is the only kingfisher that we have here in southern Idaho. And then we have the killdeer, which builds no nest at all. Lays its eggs right on the ground and they're camouflaged. But if you get close to a killdeer nest, killdeers distract their predators with a broken wing behavior. And the picture is showing you a killdeer using its broken wing behavior. And as I pointed out earlier, baby killdeer can walk away from the nest within 1 day of hatching. They're precocial. And then a more interesting bird, which kind of surprised me, and I've seen these, and that's the brown-headed cowbird. They're very common here in southern Idaho. And they're brood parasites. The female cowbird lays its eggs in the nest of other birds and then leaves. And so there are nearly 150 species that will accept the eggs and raise the cowbird. And so this is an example of one with the towhee. Not the towhee. I just pulled a blank on the name of the
Oregon towhee.
Oh. Yeah, it is the Oregon towhee. So feeding a cowbird, baby cowbird. I've also seen a sparrow feeding a cowbird in Catherine Anderson. Albertson Park. And so it's very interesting to see a small bird feeding this baby Huey, so to speak. but they do. Okay. So the next one will be the northern flicker, which is our most common woodpecker. And I think they're beautiful birds. The western northern flicker is called a red-shafted because you can see the red in his tail. In the eastern United States, they're yellow. And so their nickname in the east are called, they're called yellow hammers. But they're known for making holes in trees. They usually use them once. And so they're basically making houses for other birds. And so I've seen cavities made by flickers that have been used by starlings. In fact, I watched three or four starlings steal a nest hole from a flicker. And but they can actually they're about 3 inches in diameter, sometimes a bit more, but the cavities are 13 to 16 inches deep. And so wood ducks also use them, which is kind of hard to believe. But the point here is that flickers create nests or habitats for other cavity nesters. So any questions on nests? I guess not so.
Go ahead. Don't have any questions, but a couple of comments about the one bird, I can't remember the name, that feeds the other birds, basically gives the bird up for adoption.
Right, that's the brown-headed cowbird. And my daughter, who lives on the outskirts of Boise, said that she loved the cowbirds because she had an infestation of grasshoppers. And lo and behold, she had this huge flock of brown-headed cowbirds that showed up and ate all the grasshoppers and saved her tomatoes and her garden. And so they're not all bad, I guess is the point I'm trying to make here. So any other comments?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
So now we're going to go to mating rituals. And I have to thank my wife for putting on the videos of these. So the first one is the bald eagle. Oops. How do we get it going?
Well, are you going to talk about what they do?
Okay, so the bald eagles will, if they mate, many times they will clutch their claws together and do this aerial dance in the air, high in the air, and it's quite impressive. So
it's not a video.
This is not a video?
No.
Oh, I thought this one was a video. Okay, I guess this one isn't. We did see a video of this. It's quite impressive. So now we're going to do, this one actually is a video of mannequins.
You want to tell them where they're located?
Okay, most of these mannequins are found in Central and South America, mostly in the tropics. They're also in Southeast Asia, in the tropics.
The most complex routine is that developed by the blue mannequin. The lead male is supported by three junior dancers. They practice together almost every day. During rehearsals, a young male in juvenile plumage stands in for the female. The dance has to be perfectly synchronized. With the lead male happy, they're ready to present their dance to a female. Thank you. In a carousel of movements, each male takes his turn at the front. Forms the final move. Have they done enough? What's her decision? It's a yes.
Oh my goodness.
A great team effort.
I would have known.
What did you do?
I just tapped it. Okay. While Lisa's getting this back onto the PowerPoint, you can see that mannequins have a troop of dancers with the mannequins. We've actually seen them in Puerto Rico, not as colorful as the ones that we saw here, which were from South America. But the male dancer is generally the oldest, and all the others are younger. And they may do this like for 5 years before they get their chance. Okay, so now we're gonna see Western grebes. Now I've seen these with RL on Lake Lowell. So when you, if you were to get on the internet and see the synchronized dancing, usually what you'll find is that the male will generally give a small fish or some plant to the female first. And then they do the synchronized dancing, and then they always end with a dive into the water. And again, if they synchronize well, then they're a pair. So now we're going to go to the sexual part of birds and songbird copulation. And usually the male will approach the female, vibrating his wings excitedly, and will utter a series of chips. And if she's receptive, she'll respond in kind and shake her wings and present her back to her, to him. And then he mounts her back and will shift back and forth slightly so that their cloaca come into contact. So in a sense, it's a cloacal kiss. And this takes a second or two at the most. And the picture we have here are house sparrows, which are very common. And then something that's also kind of unusual is that are the penises, and duck penises, especially the mallard, has a corkscrew penis. But ducks, geese, swans, and other large flightless birds like ostriches have a penis. But truth be told, 97% of the birds do not have a penis. Now, this particular bird that is shown had a body length of 21 inches, but the length of his penis was 19 inches. So That's kind of an impressive penis for the size of the bird. So moving right along, the rearing of chicks. Now, most chicks tend to be altricial.
Which means
that they're born without feathers and they need to be cared for longer, usually a couple of weeks. Then we'll have the precocious baby birds, and then I'm going to show you a Canada goose nursery. So the altricial chicks, like the picture of these baby bluebirds, you see the bluebird egg there, will hatch with a minimum of feathers, and their eyes are still shut. And so they'll be in their nest several weeks and be fed by their parents until they are ready to fly, or when they fledge. That's the term that is used. Okay, so bluebirds are altricial. And then we have the precocious chicks. And ducks, geese, cranes, loons,
chickens,
quails, all have hatchlings that are covered in feathers and can walk or swim right after hatching. But the hatchlings generally stay in the nest for about 24 hours, and they often feed themselves. So they're pretty self-sufficient. By the way, that's a quail chick. Now we're going to see the Canada goose nursery. Okay, you on the goose nursery, you can tell that it's a goose nursery because there are more than two adults, and they tend to surround the young goslings. I've actually seen as many as 50 goslings surrounded by adult geese. And generally, if it's just their little group of geese or hatchlings or goslings, the female generally is in the front and the male in the back. Or it could be the other way around because you can't really tell the difference between a male and a female goose.
Question.
Any questions before we move on to flights?
No.
Good. Questions. So moving right along, we're going to cover the magnificent frigate bird, the wandering albatross, the California condor, the peregrine falcon, and hummingbird. Okay. So the magnificent frigate bird. Now the two pictures here are of females. They're white. The males are all black, and the male has a red throat. But what's significant about these frigate birds is that they can soar and not land for several days. And because they're soaring or flying day and night, one half of the brain sleeps while the other half is awake. And this occurs with many migratory birds, by the way, when they're flying nonstop. So one half of the brain shuts down and the other half remains active. And the magnificent frigate birds have about an 8-foot wingspan, and which is pretty large. And they're kleptoparasitic, meaning they steal food from other birds. And so they will attack other birds and make them cough up the food that they have, or make them release the food that they've caught, and then they will take it and eat it. And we've seen these in southern Baja California and in Central America. And they're on, you can find magnificent frigate birds on both the Atlantic and Pacific coasts. Now we'll move to the wandering albatross, which has a wingspan of 11 feet, 11 inches. And so it is the bird with the largest wingspan. And Lisa and I have seen these in New Zealand. It's an expert glider and can remain aloft for long periods without even beating its wings. And like the magnificent frigate bird, it can sleep while it flies. But you will only find these in the southern oceans. And they will actually circumnavigate the southern oceans. Now we move to the California condor. The California condor actually became extinct in the wild in 1987. And so the only ones that were alive were in zoos. And then organizations such as the Peregrine Fund began to breed the California condors. In fact, I think there are 50 breeding pairs in
World Center.
Well, at the World Center for Birds of Prey here in Boise, we have the most. And so the people who feed them actually dress up like condors so that they don't imprint on the adult, on the humans. However, sometimes they still will imprint. And so if they imprint on a human, those birds will go to a zoo. Otherwise, they will take them to Utah, Nevada, California,
Grand Canyon
of Arizona, and release them. And it's the largest North American land bird, okay? Which has a wingspan of about 10 feet and weighs about 20 pounds. And the problem that they've been having with the California condor is that they will eat carrion, but sometimes those animals have been killed with bullets that contain lead. And so the birds die of lead poisoning. And as a consequence, there's been a lot of legislation, both at state level and federal level, to do away with lead bullets. Now we have the peregrine falcon, which is one of the larger falcons, and it's a very common falcon here in southern Idaho. And but it's large to medium sized. And it is now found worldwide, but again, this bird almost became extinct. And its prey are waterfowl, shorebirds, and pigeons. Now, I've seen one hit a pigeon, and that pigeon just exploded into a big cloud of feathers. It just boggled my mind. And another incident I was in Central California in Elkhorn Slough on a boat, and we were looking at birds. And I saw this peregrine falcon coming at us, flying very low. And it was using the boat as a blind, because it, as soon as it cleared our boat, the falcon dropped down and hit a mallard duck and killed it right on the spot. I was just totally blown away by how fast that happened. And they kill it with their claws. But they do very well here in southern Idaho, in the Snake River Gorge, because of the cliffs. And so those are prime nesting areas. But they also have started nesting in skyscrapers and cities. And so we have a pair that nests in Boise. And where I used to live in San Jose, California, they had a couple of pairs there. And their primary source of food are pigeons.
There's video cams sometimes.
Yeah, and you can find video cams. And this is blocking my last slide. But anyway, I tell you that the peregrine falcon is considered one of the fastest flying birds.
They can see it.
Yeah, they've been clocked at 223 miles an hour in a stoop or dive. And that's how they usually hit birds or attack other birds. But just flying on the level, they probably fly around 60 miles an hour, which is not too shabby, actually. So go to a hummingbird. And the hummingbird is the only bird that moves its wings in a figure eight rather than up and down. And because of that wing pattern, it's the only bird that can fly backwards. And it consumes half of its weight in sugar or nectar. And I will make a comment that if all they ate was sugar or nectar, they would starve to death because they need protein. And so what you'll find is hummingbirds will also eat insects, and they eat the insects for the protein. Now, they only occur in the Americas, and there are over 300 species. And what's kind of interesting is hummingbirds cannot walk or hop, although they can use their feet to hang on to a branch. And they have over 900 feathers, which is actually the fewest number of feathers in the bird world. Okay, and the other thing is their heartbeats beat at about 1,200 beats per minute, which is pretty impressive compared to a human. Like, my heartbeat would be about 60 beats per minute. And so you can see that hummingbirds have a heart that's really pumping quite rapidly. And as a consequence, hummingbirds don't live a long time. I think if you found a hummingbird that was 5 years old, it would be old. Now we're going to go into migration. By the way, I got that picture from Fort Boise, and those are snow geese migrating. But we're going to talk about some special birds: the Arctic tern, the bristle-tailed godwit, red knots, Swainson's hawk, which you can also see here in Idaho, and sandhill crane, which you can also see here. So, the Arctic tern. The Arctic tern migrates from northern Canada and Alaska to Tierra del Fuego in southern South America and the Antarctica in the fall. And then, so they're always in summertime somewhere. And then later they will, in the spring, will migrate from southern South America to northern North America. And then they will breed in the summer in the north. And the Arctic tern flies about 25,000 miles every year, which is pretty impressive, I think. It's constantly on the move. Okay. But it never spends winter in the snow. Okay. And when we went to New Zealand, I really wanted to see the bar-tailed godwit, and we did. And the bar-tailed godwit will fly 7,000 miles nonstop from Alaska to New Zealand across the Pacific Ocean. So that what they do is, during that Alaska summer, they will bulk up to 2.5 times their normal body weight, because all that fat that they're building up is fuel. And then they fly across the Pacific to New Zealand. And so by the time they get to New Zealand, they've actually consumed all of their body weight, all the fat, and they're less than their normal body weight. And so then they will, in New Zealand, eat grubs and snails and mussels, and then when they do their return flight to Alaska, they will, rather than flying directly across the Pacific, they'll follow the coast of China and Korea. And one of the problems that we're seeing is they're being threatened by the coastal development of marshlands in China. And so birders have been working with the Chinese to leave those marshlands alone so that this bar-tailed godwit can survive. And then red knots, another small bird, and it migrates from southern South America to Delaware Bay, and then to the northern Arctic. And they stop in Delaware Bay, they feed on horseshoe crab eggs and tiny clams and mussel spat. And they're being threatened by the over-harvesting of horseshoe crabs. And the horseshoe crabs have been here since before the dinosaur. But it turns out that they are blue-blooded, and some companies are using crab blood for studies of cures for diseases. And other people, like fishermen, are using the horseshoe crabs for bait. And so there was a considerable drop in the horseshoe crab population. And as a consequence, there was a huge drop in the red knot population. And so in order to save the red knots, they are now trying to reduce the amount of harvesting of horseshoe crabs. And so here's a map that shows that the red knots will fly from Tierra del Fuego all the way up to Delaware Bay and the coast of New Jersey, and then go on up to their breeding grounds in the Arctic. And so the red knots also fly about 20,000 miles each year. Now we'll go to the Swainson's hawk. It's a mid-sized broadwing hawk, easily confused with the red-tailed hawk, but the difference would be in the wings. So if you look at a hawk like this one, the trailing edge of the wings is dark on a Swainson's, whereas on the red tail, the front of the wing is dark. Okay. And these hawks like to eat locusts and grasshoppers, as well as ground squirrels. And they winter in Argentina and in the summer They'll breed here in Idaho, and they fly about 7,000 miles each way. It turns out they have the second longest migration of raptors. And you can see how they move or migrate. Now, unlike the red knots and the other birds, they have to land frequently. And so they follow land and they don't cross large bodies of water like the Gulf of Mexico. And but there was a major cause of the Swainson's hawk population because of pesticide use in Argentina. They were using DDT to kill grasshoppers. And then the hawks were eating the grasshoppers and dying from the DDT. Now we're moving to sandhill cranes. And they're actually the oldest known surviving North American bird species. They've been around for like 2.5 million years. And they're gray with red foreheads and white cheeks, and they have dark bills and dark legs. And the sexes look alike, and they're about 3 feet tall. And by the way, the whooping cranes are about 5 feet tall. And what's amazing to me is that the sandhill crane is a game bird, except for the state of Nebraska. And so in many states, you can hunt them, shoot them and eat them, which amazes me. There are actually 6 subspecies of sandhill crane, and the most endangered are the eastern sandhill cranes. And there is one subspecies in Cuba that does not migrate at all, just stays in Cuba. But most migrate from Mexico to Alaska. And so there's a great book called On Ancient Wings by Michael Forsberg that describes the sandhill cranes in quite detail. They also are known for having the largest bird call, the loudest bird call, because you can hear sandhill cranes from 2 miles away. And many times I look up in the sky and I can see them, and they're migrating, they're flying, but they're flying at about 5,000 feet. So they're way, way up there. They're very high. They fly much higher than most birds.
Any questions?
So are there any questions?
Yes. Let's see. We're going back to, it looks like some of these questions came in after our topic. One is on the goose nursery. How many does one couple usually have? And how many goose, how many gooselings in a brood?
Okay, usually they're about a dozen. And it's interesting because in the springtime, the male and the female stay together. And generally, most of those goslings will survive. So like I said, there's about a dozen. And I'd say that I've seen nurseries that have numbered as large as 60. And what happens is pairs will be designated to take care of the goslings while all the other adults are feeding. And if you see a group of Canada geese feeding, there'll always be 2 or 3 on the edges, the outer edges of the group, who will not be feeding. They'll be standing up tall and alert and looking for any dangerous animals that may attack them, and so that they can give warning. And so in contrast, a mallard duck, for example, the male comes, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am, and they move on. And then the female raises their chicks by themselves, the ducklings. But what you'd find is that the female ducks will have maybe a dozen babies at the start of the season. But by the end of the season, there'll only be two or three left. And so the death rate among mallards is very high because in most cases, the male ducks don't help in raising the young, which is in contrast to the geese. So were there any other questions?
It's kind of a question. So one couple of the goose have 12 babies, but the nursery can have up to 60. Is that correct?
Yeah, or even more.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it.
When you see the nurseries, they're on the water. So it's a cooperative effort, and being out on the water is much safer than being on land.
So in that video that you showed, it had like two grown geese in the front and then two grown geese in the back. So is that considered a nursery of all those goslings in between?
Yes. But if you had noticed in that video that sometimes the adults, one in the back and one in the front, would fall back and be on the sides. They were actually on the sides keeping the goslings together. So the goslings didn't wander off. Whereas if you're watching a group of ducks, you'll always find two or three ducks just wandering away and then paddling like crazy to catch up again. But it's when they wander off like that they're prey for other animals. In fact, I've even seen gulls come down and take a small duckling. It's one of their favorite treats, if you will.
Wow. Isn't nature wonderful? That's it for the questions for now.
Okay, so we'll move on from the sandhill cranes and go to intelligence and dealing with brain size and behavior. And there's this one researcher who purchased this African gray parrot and named him Alex. And in fact, there's a book called Alex and Me by Irene Pepperburton. And Alex had a vocabulary of 100 words. He could identify 50 different objects and recognize quantities up to 6. He could distinguish 7 colors and 5 shapes. And Alex understood the concepts of bigger and smaller, same and different. And he is the first non-human to ask a question. Other animals like chimps never ask questions. And he also made comments like, "You be good. I love you. See you tomorrow." And a great read is Alex and Me.
There's videos too online.
And there are also videos.
Watch him performing.
Right. So very famous parrot. Now I'll go to corvids. Like the parrots, corvids are considered to be very smart. And they include crows, jays, and magpies. What's interesting is you won't find any crows in Central and South America. But you will find jays and magpies. And in North America, meaning Mexico, Canada, and the US, there are actually 4 species of crow. And if you go to Europe, you'll also find the crows are different. They have jackdaws and rooks and ravens, which are the largest species, are in Europe and in North America. And crows are known to make and use tools. and crows are famous for remembering faces of people, especially people they don't like. And there are some, there's a very good book out of the University of Washington where they studied crows. And it's called The Gifts of Crows, or The Gifts of the Crow. And where they did studies on the crows, and they had people who were mean to the crows and wore Richard Nixon face masks. And so anyone who was walking on the University of Washington campus wearing a Nixon face mask would get attacked by the crows. And so that one really gets into a lot of detail on the brain size, and it's more scientific. Okay. And a lighter one would be Crows: Encounters with the Wise Guys of the Avian World. That'd be another book that you might find interesting. And now we come to the owls. Now, owls are the ubiquitous symbol of wisdom in modern society. And yet, owls don't rate very high on the intelligence scale. And the region of the brain concerned with perceiving sound is much more complex in owls than in other birds. And the owl eyes are very large and virtually immobile. And so the owl eyes will take up, and the owl eyes and ears take up most of the brain or the skull capacity. And there's a great book called Owls Aren't Wise and Bats Aren't Blind by Warner Shedd. And so I'll tell you something about the owls. So only 1/3 of the skull volume is actually dedicated to the brain. And so in this slide, you can actually see where the eyes are on this skull on the left and how they take up a lot of space. And how the ears, what's unique about the ears also on the owl is that they're asymmetrical in size and in position. And that enables the owl to triangulate with sound by hearing small rodents and stuff. And so even with their eyes shut, they could pick out where an owl is based on their ears. I mean, where a mouse is. And in the picture on the right, you can see that the brain cavity itself is actually maybe a third, a fourth to a third of the skull. So owls actually are not the brightest bird in the neighborhood. But they're still very efficient killers. And so now we're going to go to extinction. Oh, any questions before we go to extinction?
Yes. Let's see. How old is Alex the parrot? And what was the question he asked?
I'm not sure what the question was, but
he lived about 30 years.
I think he was like 30 to 35.
Is he still alive?
No, he died. But parrots have been known to live to be as old as 100. And usually parrots that are pets live longer than parrots in the wild.
And a comment, so Edgar Allan Poe and the Raven, American, but none in America. So there's no ravens in America?
Yeah, no, we do have ravens. We have ravens on North America and in Europe. But, and his bird only said one word, nevermore. You know, and so, yeah, We have ravens here. In fact, we have ravens and crows here in southern Idaho.
South America, where they are.
Yeah, it's, and in fact, here in the Treasure Valley, you'll tend to see crows in the cities and ravens out in the country. And where you don't find crows would be in Central and South America.
Okay. All right, that's it for the questions.
Good.
Thank you.
So now we'll move to extinction. So we're going to be covering habitat destruction, DDT, and diclofenac, Chinese sparrows, passenger pigeon, cats, urban lights, and global warming. And a book that I would recommend on this would be Nature's Best Hope by Douglas Tallamy. And so it's really targeted. Its subtitle is A New Approach to Conservation That Starts in Your Yard. And so it's really targeted to individuals, and not necessarily organizations. So with habitat destruction, for example, in the Great Plains, we're producing a lot of corn, wheat, rice, and soy. And same goes for Central Valley of California. And those are kind of like deserts for birds because in prior times, those were grasslands, and birds were accustomed to eating food from those grasslands. Then another issue is the destruction of forests. And so in different countries like the United States, we've actually harvested most of our forests. And then we also have the issue of forest fires. And so most birds tend to go to forests to live. And there are a lot of birds that live in the forest and some that live at the edge of forests. And so the destruction of forests is a big issue. It's also a big issue in the Amazon River region because they are destroying thousands of acres every day so they can convert it to the production of soy. And in Central America, I noticed a lot of the forests have been destroyed so that they could grow palm trees for palm oil. And in fact, it's amazing how many things have palm oil in our foods. And so, and in pineapples, same thing. And so, and the other one would be bananas. They've taken out forests and grown bananas. Of course, there are people like myself who eat a banana a day, so I can't really complain. So then the other issue is the destruction of marshes and wetlands. And so the EPA is working to try to maintain wetlands, especially in the central flyway, meaning Kansas, Nebraska, the Dakotas, all the way up into Canada, because a lot of those migrating birds need those marshes for their for food, and especially when they're migrating. Then on the coastal regions, there's the destruction of mangroves, which has a huge impact on egrets and herons who tend to nest in mangroves. So moving right along, DDT. In 1961, there was a link made between DDT and eggshell thinning. And what they found was we were losing most of our bald eagles and peregrine falcons. And in the EPA banned DDT in 1972. By then, peregrine falcons were extirpated in the eastern United States, and in the Arctic populations were halved. And it actually took 26 years for the peregrine falcon to return to normal. And again, it was organizations like the Peregrine Fund, which helped bring back these raptors from the edge of extinction. And so now you can go worldwide and find peregrine falcon. And but then DDT, except for countries like Argentina, have actually outlawed the use of DDT. So, and there's actually a book called The DDT Wars that describes how we were able to stop the use of DDT in the United States. And then I wanted to mention the vultures of India and diclofenac. And so in the 1990s, the vulture population of India and Pakistan dropped by 99% in 20 years. So from 20 million vultures to 19,000. And the reason was diclofenac was given to cattle. And that caused kidney failure in vultures. And it was finally banned in India in 2006. But from the 1990s to 2006, well, even after 2006, livestock diseases such as anthrax and hoof and mouth disease increased. And then foxes and feral dog populations increased, which resulted in rabies populations. And so there was like a rabies epidemic. And the vultures actually were the ones who were eating the cattle so that they didn't have diseases like anthrax and foot and mouth. And as recently as 2013, diclofenac was still used in Spain, and their vultures, the griffon vultures, were being eliminated. Then Lisa and I went to China, and we discovered that the Chinese in 1958-59 had declared a war against sparrows, because in 1958, Mao Zedong urged people to kill sparrows, flies, rats, and mosquitoes. And 2 billion sparrows were killed. And despite a successful harvest in 1959, the crops were destroyed by locusts, and then they had a famine that resulted in 10 to 30 million Chinese dying. Because the sparrows were eating the insects, and now they had no sparrows to eat the insects. No, it was sparrows and small birds. And so here are two pictures of cartload of sparrows and truckload of sparrows, dead sparrows that the people had killed.
Now, why were they killing the sparrows again?
Because Mao thought that they were eating too much grain.
Oh.
And so the idea was that they would, if they didn't eat the grain, there'd be more grain for the people to eat. But they were also eating the insects. And that's where birds are very beneficial. They probably eat more insects than grain. So moving right along, passenger pigeon, which was a bird that was endemic to North America, mostly the United States. And so in the late 1700s, there were somewhere between 3 and 5 billion, with a B, pigeons. And these huge migratory flocks would pass over all day long. So one flock in Wisconsin covered 850 square miles, estimated to have 136 million birds. but they were hunted into extinction. And the last passenger pigeon died in 1914 in a zoo in Cincinnati, Ohio. And so urban lights, 80% of the North American birds migrate at night, and city lights have a negative impact on bird migration by confusing them when they use stars to guide them. And they're attracted to the windows, and the urban lights also result in more window collisions and bird deaths. So now there's policy for a lot of cities to shut down lights. Cats kill something like 2.4 billion birds a year. So outdoor cats contribute to 33 extinctions of birds globally. Cats are the biggest killer of birds. And so some preventive steps are: make your cat an indoor cat, use bird be safe collars, spay neuter, and adopt cats, and use in-ground electric fences. And I know our daughter uses a cat patio for her outdoor cat. So in global warming, we've had higher temperatures, which negatively affect breeding productivity. It also affects the timing of the food supply, especially for the migrating birds. And the higher temperatures and drought increases forest fires, thereby reducing bird habitat. And global warming has created more intense hurricanes, which also results in the destruction of bird habitat. So any questions before we go to bird benefits? So with bird benefits,
Wait. Let's see. No, it was just a comment. Okay, go ahead, continue.
So I've thrown in beauty, insect control, pollination, cleanup crew, disease prevention, enjoyment, food source, and communication. So here we go. Most of us enjoy the beauty of birds and watching wild birds, and there are so many of them that are just beautiful. And birds and their feathers are still used as adornment. Although there's a law against harvesting feathers. Insect control. Birds keep the world safe from the plagues of insects, and birds are technologically advanced, highly motivated, extremely efficient, and cost-effective as insect pest controllers. The breeding season for birds occurs when the insect populations are highest, and birds are highly mobile, and many of these birds take advantage of the local insect outbreaks by moving into the infected areas. As I mentioned, the cowbirds saved my daughter's tomatoes by eating the insects. And you may know that in Utah, their state bird is the California gull, because the Mormons had a insect population, a locust infestation that was destroying their crops, and the gulls came and ate the locusts and saved their crops. And next is pollination. So birds pollinate flowers and trees, and birds mostly pollinate wildflowers, and there are over 2,000 species of pollinating birds. And seed dispersal, I like the acorn woodpecker because it stores acorns and they're cute. Birds eating fruit and the whole seed of the fruit then passes through the bird's digestive tract. And so they disperse seeds and birds gather seeds and store them for later use. Plus, seeds can stick to the birds and fall off later. So they're known for seed dispersal. And then we have cleanup crew. Magpies eat fruit, grain, insects, rodents, eggs, and carrion. And gulls will eat French fries, popcorn, bread. They'll also eat roadkill, fish, waste, food waste in dumpsters. And it's not unusual to go to a Denny's and see gulls eating waste food and French fries.
What about the dumps?
And then if you want to see a lot of, if you wanted to go to the landfill, the Boise landfill, you would see thousands of gulls up there eating waste. And then frozen ravens will eat carrion, that's dead animals, grapes, fruit, potatoes, and peanuts. So they do a lot of cleanup. And then disease prevention. One of my favorite birds is the turkey vulture, because it's the only bird or only animal that can destroy the bubonic plague and the hanta virus. And believe it or not, we actually have ground squirrels south of Boise that have bubonic plague and hanta virus, but the turkey vultures keep them under control. And there are several species of birds that eat carrion or dead animals. And then raptors eat rodents and other birds, and generally eat the old, weak, and the sick, so help maintain healthy populations. And then for enjoyment, birds are used as pets and in backyard birding, like we do at home. And then we have a lot of personal contact with wild birds. And then birds are used as a food source. So Americans eat 81 pounds of chicken every year. And we also eat eggs. Consumption of eggs is 286.5 eggs per person per year. And we eat turkey, 15.8 pounds of turkey per capita in 2020. And of course, Thanksgiving, we 40 million turkeys are eaten every year, just for Thanksgiving. And then communication, our last one, which is homing pigeons. Homing pigeons were used for communication during wars. And I've listed a book here. The book is based on a true story of homing or carrier or messenger pigeons used during World War I. This book was based on World War I. They were used by the US Army during World War I and World War II. But homing pigeons have been used to carry messages as far back as 2900 BC in Egypt. And so I did want to mention that that book is written by Robert Burley, but it's illustrated by our nephew, Robert McKenzie. It's a children's book. So go out and buy the book. So anyway, I'm kidding. It's a cute book though. And then they've been used in ancient times in ancient China, Persia, India, and in Greece.
And aren't dolphins used for hunting?
Yeah, but that's not communication. So, and that ends. There are other things that I could have talked about. I totally eliminated cranes and, I mean, egrets and herons, which are among my favorite birds. There are so many more things you could do on bird trivia, but I only have so much time, and so that's it. Safe and easy. Any last questions?
No, just comments of thank you. Best class I've attended this year. Thank you for sharing your knowledge with us. And yeah, this was awesome, Alexander. This was awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
So thank you everyone for attending today, and thank you to our presenter, Alexander Sapiens. And be sure to go online and check out the New Knowledge Adventures classes that are still upcoming. This particular class has been recorded and will be available on YouTube, but all you have to do is Google Idaho NKA, I believe. Sheena, correct me if I'm wrong. Idaho NKA.
NKA Idaho, but that, both of them will work.
NKA Idaho, thank you. So you'll be able to find this class as well as all of the other classes that have been recorded. So thank you for attending, and I hope you continue to enjoy the classes that we present. So thank you all, and this concludes our session.
Thanks.